Ryan Thomas with EastWest here, and welcome to the new official walkthrough for EastWest Pianos. Now, we had done one of these a few years ago, but we wanted to take a fresh look within the context of the OPUS engine. So EastWest Pianos is a collection of four meticulously sampled world-class pianos, a Bechstein 280, Bösendorfer 290, the classic Steinway D, and a Yamaha C7, and there's over 280 gigabytes of sample content. In this video, we're going to review the basic structure of the library and how it works, and we'll also discuss sort of the philosophy of use for each of these pianos. We're also going to talk about what the groundbreaking new features in the OPUS engine bring to these incredible instruments, and of course, there will be plenty of demos. So let's go ahead and start exploring EastWest Pianos. Now, the structure of the library is pretty simple. You've got your four pianos here, and within each one, you'll have four folders. You'll have the full patches DYN, the light patches, and the light patches DYN. And DYN just stands for dynamic layers, so those patches are going to contain the highest number of dynamic layers, in some cases up to 18 per note, which is why you have over 280 gigabytes of sample content in the library. That said, I should point out that the Yamaha C7 just has the full and light patches, but there's still an incredible amount of detail with this piano, as you'll hear in just a moment. So in each one of these folders, you'll find a master patch, which is going to load all of the articulations recorded with the instrument, as well as individual articulations that can be loaded if you really need to save on RAM and don't need that much detail. That said, I would recommend in most cases just pulling up the master patches because it is going to load the sustain, sustain pedal, repetitions, repetitions pedal, sustain soft pedal, staccato, and release samples into memory. And you really do need all of those articulations in order to have maximal realism in a piano library. Because, for example, the release on a staccato note is going to be a little bit different from the release on a sustain. And while the RAM footprint is kind of significant, for example, in this patch, it's going to be 715 megabytes, there's a really cool new feature in the OPUS engine that allows you to use even these big patches with a very minimal RAM footprint. And to show you how this feature works, I'm going to go ahead and purge this instrument from RAM, so no samples are currently loaded into memory at the moment. And notice that as I start playing, the RAM usage is going to tick up as OPUS is loading only the notes that I'm playing and only the dynamics that I'm playing into memory. So this feature works really beautifully, especially with those big orchestral pieces where you might just have a minimalistic piano part like the one that I just played, and you don't need to load all 715 megabytes of the full instrument. Now we're just using 4.3 megabytes. So it's a really cool feature, very useful, especially if you are working with limited RAM resources. Now, in order to make use of this feature, you don't have to load an instrument and then manually purge it every time. You can just go into Preferences, select Never Preload, and then OPUS will always load instruments in a purged state by default. So that's another really cool feature of the OPUS engine. Okay, let's go ahead and check out the interface, and we'll start with the sensitivity curve. And this is going to determine the velocity with which you have to hit a key in order to trigger the next highest dynamic layer. So if it's set like it is now, you're going to have to be fairly deliberate in order to trigger those higher dynamic layers, which is a really good thing if you are on a non-weighted keyboard because it makes it more difficult to accidentally trigger a note that kind of sticks out in volume. Now, obviously, a perfectly linear curve is going to give you a very linear response. And then if you set it like this, which I wouldn't really recommend unless you're working on a very heavily weighted keyboard, the dynamic layers are going to ramp up very quickly. So I would recommend, again, if you're working on a non-weighted keyboard, to just kind of keep the curve right around here, maybe, I think is the sweet spot. Down here, you've got the articulations, which you can load or unload, depending on what you want. And then you've got the volume envelope. And I wouldn't really recommend changing this. Set like it is now, you're going to get that nice, beautiful, natural piano sound. but you can adjust various parameters in order to get more non-traditional sounds. So if we set the attack up a little bit further, you can get some really interesting textures. So you can obviously have a lot of fun with that. Next, let's talk about the ambiences. Now, you have this entire list of really high quality convolution reverbs to choose from. If you want to use the internal reverb in the Opus player, you can turn it on and off with this button and obviously change the amount. Now, I've opted to just use EastWest Spaces 2 for convenience. I really love the LA Piano Hall rear room with the 3.2 second tail. I'm using this reverb for all of the pianos in this walkthrough. And then we have the lid position. So closed gives you this really warm and intimate sound. And then open is going to give you this big, full, and lush sound. So you can hear that really does have quite a profound effect on the sound. Now, the stereo spread control basically duplicates the signal, creates a short delay between them, and then pans them left or right, depending on the value that you have the knob set to. So you can get some really cool effects with this. If you want the most natural sound, I would just leave it at the default value. But if you want some really cool effects, then you can play around with it a bit. Finally, let's talk about the microphone controls, and they're pretty intuitive. You just click on the button to load the various mic positions, and these sliders obviously affect the volume. And I should point out that when you load these microphone positions, you are loading an entirely new set of samples recorded with different mics in the different positions. So you're not just loading effects or impulse responses. Now, one really cool thing that you can do in Opus is automate these mic position sliders by just right-clicking on them and selecting Learn MIDI Assignment, and then moving a knob or slider on your keyboard. So this would be really useful if I was working on a piece and I wanted the close mic for one section, but then maybe just the room mic for another, and I can very easily automate that without having to create two separate tracks. So that's another really, really cool function in the Opus player. And I can actually just go over here in automation to see the macro that I just created. And if you want to delete it, all you have to do is right click on the slider again and select remove MIDI assignment. So let's go ahead and look at each of these pianos individually, starting with the Bechstein. And the Bechstein is this beautiful, full, classic 9-foot grand piano with a very precise sound. And what I mean by that is that each note individually is fairly thin, which actually makes it a great candidate for being an orchestral piano, because it's not going to overwhelm the rest of the instruments with this huge, full sound. It also makes it ideal, I think, for very complex and dense passages, because each note is going to speak very clearly. So here is the mic position that I kind of settled on after playing with it for a little bit. Obviously, you'll need to tailor the sound to the piece that you are writing. If this was in an orchestral context, I might mix these mics a little bit differently. But by itself, this was the mic mix that I liked the most. And check out this incredible dynamic range. Now, as I mentioned before, I think this piano sits really well in an orchestral context, especially when you get to the top of its range and it just sounds so pure and delicate. But it's really easy, especially on a non-weighted keyboard, to hit a note just a little bit too hard and trigger a velocity that kind of sticks out. So what I'm going to do is go over into the MIDI tools panel, which is new with the OPUS engine, and I'm going to add a MIDI compressor. And what this is going to do is compress all velocities above the threshold that you set by the ratio that you set. So I've already made a preset for this piano that I'm going to go ahead and load. And I would really want this for a passage like this. So again, no matter how hard I hit the key, you're really not going to get a velocity too far over 60. That's hitting the key about as hard as I can. So again, this works really well when you're playing those really delicate passages and you don't want to have to worry about going back and editing the MIDI because, again, you accidentally hit a key just a little bit too hard. All right, now let's go ahead and talk about one of my absolute favorite patches in the library, and that is the Bechstein Classic Pop. And this was recorded by producer and engineer Ken Scott, who recorded a similar Bechstein piano on Supertramp's Crime of the Century. And it just has that really classic, bright pop rock sound that sits well in pretty much any mix without really much processing at all. When I've used this in the past, I've added just a little bit of compression and it's just perfect. Now, I should note that this just comes with the one mic position, but trust me when I say that that's all you'll need. And the panning on this is actually part of the sound. So yeah, it's almost a different piano entirely just due to the way that it was recorded and mixed. The Bechstein just has that much range. Okay, let's go ahead and check out the Bösendorfer next. As you just heard, this piano has such a beautiful and warm sound, and this particular Bösendorfer model, which is the 290, has a 98-key layout, and this particular instrument has been broken in over a number of years by a Russian concert pianist. So again, it just has this really lush and warm tone with just a ton of dynamics, and this one is really ideal, I think, for those flowing passages. And it also sits well in an orchestral context at the lower dynamics. This one also has some really ear-pleasing staccato, especially at the lower dynamics. That would sound really cool with some pizzicato basses or celli. And another really useful MIDI tool, especially for the passage that you're about to hear, is the humanizer. And I'm going to go ahead and load it up. And we're just going to set the note on delay to 20 milliseconds. That seems to be about the sweet spot. And then I'm going to turn it off so that you can hear this passage without the humanizer. I just played this in and then quantized it. And of course, it sounds like a quantized passage. So let's go ahead and turn the humanizer on. And of course, it sounds a lot more human and natural. So that's a really cool and useful MIDI tool. And that is going to do it for the Bösendorfer. Let's move on to the Steinway. And you, of course, just heard the Steinway D. It's an absolute powerhouse of a piano with an insane dynamic range, and it's so versatile. It's kind of my go-to orchestral piano for most applications because it has a really pure, clear, bell-like quality to it that is going to be able to speak through the mix even in denser orchestrations and even when the piano is playing at lower dynamics. So even though we're playing at a super soft dynamic, it just cuts through so easily and so clearly without being harsh. Again, I just love this piano for those really delicate orchestral applications. Now, you probably noticed that I have all three mic positions enabled for this piano, and I have a good bit of the room mic mixed in as well, which can be problematic if you are using a lot of reverb. So Opus has this really cool feature that allows you to have each microphone on its own track. And I'm gonna go ahead and show you how to do that right now. And I do wanna point out that this process is gonna look a little bit different depending on which digital audio workstation you are working in. But in Logic Pro, I'm gonna start by loading Opus as a multi-output instance, and it's gonna save all my settings. And now we have this little plus and minus button in our mixer track, and I'm gonna create three tracks here. And I'm gonna call this one the close mic. We're gonna call this one the player mic. And this one is the room mic. All right, now you wanna go into the mix window in Opus and assign your mics to these tracks. So you'll notice this says Opus 3 and 4. This says Opus 5 and 6. And this track says Opus 7 and 8. So we are just going to assign these mic positions to their respective tracks. And now, if I solo this track here, you are only going to hear the close mic. And what I can do is just select these three microphones, right-click, and select Create Track. And now I can see all of these tracks in my main window, which is really cool. And what this allows me to do is be really precise with how much reverb I'm applying to each microphone position. Because the fact is, I actually don't want any of the room mic going to a reverb because it's already got a lot of early reflections and sounds quite spacious. So I just want some of the player mic and some of the close mic going to reverbs. So I'm going to cue up the previous demo, and we are going to mix these mic positions in real time. So I'm going to send all three of these to my EastWest Spaces 2 reverb. And like I said, I'm probably not going to end up sending really any from the room mic, but let's start with the close mic. All right, that's sounding pretty good to me. Now let's add the player mic. All right, that's sounding pretty close. And then we're gonna add the room mic. And I'm probably gonna send just a little bit to a reverb. So that's obviously a really powerful functionality in OPUS, and it allows you to just be really precise with how you're applying the reverb to the various mic positions. So let's go ahead and end our tour of EastWest Pianos with the Yamaha C7. So as you just heard, this piano really shines in the context of rock and pop, and it's also a really good jazz piano and is great for orchestral pop productions like Writing on the Wall by Sam Smith or something of that nature. It's obviously got a fairly bright tone, but at the lower dynamics, it can also be dark enough to be suitable for some film work, I think, although I don't know that it would be my go-to piano for, you know, traditional orchestral film scoring. I'd probably pick the Steinway D or the Bösendorfer for that. But in any case, I really like the player mic with just a little bit of the close mic mixed in. I found that to be a pretty good overall sound for this piano. So let's give it another listen here. Yeah, so it's just got so much dynamic range to it, and I wanted to show you one thing that I like to do with this piano in terms of the mix. And because this piano is so bright and dynamic, and of course, in many cases, it's going to be in the context of a rock or pop piece, you're probably going to want to have some compression on it. And I really love the SSL bus compressor that is built into the OPUS engine. It's a very musical compressor. I've had it turned off while we've been listening to the piano, but I'm going to go ahead and enable it. And I'm gonna slowly back down the threshold until the compressor starts to kick in so that you can hear what it's doing. I've already set the ratio attack and release to the values that I like. And by the way, if you wanna add an effect onto a channel strip, all you have to do is click on this plus sign and you have your choice of all these beautiful effects in Opus. So let's go ahead and give this a listen. So as you could see, we were compressing the piano quite a bit by the end there, but it still sounded very natural, and that compressor really fattens up the sound in a very ear-pleasing way. So that is going to conclude this walkthrough. I want to remind you that all of these pianos are available with a Composer Cloud Plus subscription, and there's really nothing that you can't do very well with these. They're really ideal for everything from album and production work to scoring for film and other media. So in any case, I want to thank you so much for watching. Don't forget to like, comment, subscribe, and hit that notification bell. And we look forward to seeing you in the next video.